Center is here to show you some very simple measures to ensure that the user experience remains the same throughout all platforms. We have Aditee here with us. Aditee has worked extensively with enterprise customers in India and abroad, architecting and designing large-scale enterprise solutions on Microsoft Stack, and she has specific expertise in retail, manufacturing, pharma, and at Microsoft, Aditee leads technical evangelism for India. She is also a proponent of women in technology, which is fantastic, and is passionate about helping women build and sustain long-term careers in IT, and also helps with women entrepreneurs. So, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and give Aditee a warm welcome. Thanks.
Thanks for inviting me here for this talk on responsive design. When I was thinking about what to talk about, I was told that most of the people that I hear in the audience are going to be web developers, designers, and people who founded their own companies. And I thought this is a very opportune moment to really talk about the universal vision with guys like Microsoft and Google and communities like Mozilla, etc., to talk about what the vision for the web is and really seek support from all of you guys to help us realize that vision and take it forward. So this is what the talk is really going to be based on. My name is Aditee Rele. I guess you've heard an introduction. I lead technical evangelism for Microsoft in India. And web is one of our core motions that we're driving as a part of technical evangelism for developers. So before we get into responsive design, I just want to quickly recap the state of the web. So if you look at the web today, it's been 25 years since the web was really launched for the public. Since then, back then in 95, there used to be a browser called AOL for which you had to pay to use. And then Internet Explorer came on board and, it kind of disrupted the entire browser ecosystem, made it free, made the web available for everyone. And at that time, there was no such thing as conforming to standards. There was only Internet Explorer. There was no governing body trying to define what a web standard should be. And quite honestly, we went berserk with what we could do with the web. There was a lot of, loose standards, loose specifications, a whole bunch of ActiveX, a whole bunch of plugins, a whole bunch of things that you could just do on the browser and basically let the developers really loose. And then as the web evolved, the concept of how do we standardize this entire ecosystem came into the play. And the primary reason that came into the play is Internet Explorer ceased to be the only browser that people used. I mean, we'll not talk about enterprise for a bit, but from a consumer perspective, these are only the ones that I list out here, the Firefox, the Safari, and the Chrome, are only those browsers that we see today as big browsers. But quite honestly, if you go to a website called caniuse.com, you will see like a plethora of browsers out there, including Opera, Opera Mini, mobile browsers, and some unknown browser names that we've not even heard about. So the concept, really today we're at a situation where there are many browser companies who are building browsers, and then there's a governing body called the W3C, who's really dictating how the web should be developed. They're dictating, but they're not mandating. So therefore, we don't have to really conform to what they have to say. But because they're the governing body, it makes sense to address the standards that they specify. So that is really the way the web is. But today, and all these years that we've talked about from 95 until 2012-13, we've talked about web on the PC. We've never really bothered about what goes beyond the web. But today, the world of computing is changing itself. So for example, you're seeing mobile, which is true. All of us have a different kind of a mobile device. Even if you're using an Android phone, I'm sure you guys are using a different specification of the Android operating system on your phone. So essentially, there's a variety of mobile devices out there. There's a variety of, tablet form factors or phablet form factors also. PC is not the only person that we're talking about. But beyond these two, beyond the mobile and the PC form factors, we're also looking at innovative personal computing devices such as the Xbox, such as the Apple TV, such as HoloLens, such as Oculus Rift. We're looking at IoT scenarios. You must have heard the talk this morning about how IoT is really getting mainstream. So in that case, it is going to happen that the web also comes on a device and you're able to sort of build a machine that sends information back to you, and you can actually manipulate the information on the machine using a browser-based interface and so on and so forth. So there's a whole variety of devices out there that we are not catering to today, and we need to start catering to going forward. But it's not just form factors. It's also about what people expect. I'm going to build this slide up so it's easy to kind of talk. So it's also what people expect, right? It's mobility of experience. If I'm used to consuming certain experience on my PC, I expect that same experience to also happen on the plethora of other devices that I use. So for example, in office, I'm on the PC, and when I'm traveling on my phone, when I get home, I probably want to relax and use my tablet. I don't want my websites or my applications to look different. And however much we tell the whole world about, hey, this is, the world is trending towards native applications. Yes, absolutely, the world is trending towards native applications. But today, a good chunk of users still consume the web experience. There is a leading bank in Mumbai that gives you a specific message when you go to their website using your mobile phone. They say, oh, we've enabled some important features for you on the mobile, but if you want to use the entire set of features, go log on from a PC. That's not a desirable experience in today's world. I want to be able to consume whatever is online from whichever device I want. That's one. The other thing is, we have this tendency to be always connected. Yes, that's a bit of a challenge in India. Remote locations do not have connectivity at all times. But the fact is that today, consumers expect to be always connected. Consumers expect to have high-speed networks. Consumers expect that you do not have to wait until you get information back, or in case of enterprise applications or field force applications, wait for information to be sent back. You don't want to wait. And then there's also smarter and more personal computing. We expect, so this is an example from 2 days ago when I was going to pick up my aunt at the airport. I wanted to check the flight status, and all I did was went onto my phone and typed Qatar Airways flight status, Doha to Mumbai. I wasn't expecting a link or a set of links that came through. What I was expecting is for the browser to tell me the exact status as soon as I searched for it. And you have, these days, devices are smarter, they integrate with APIs like flight stats in this case, to show me the result set right there. If I want to know when is Diwali next year, I don't want to be given a link to Kalyanai. I want to know exactly the date when it happened, right in the search results itself. So we expect a lot from our devices as well. In addition, there's also a changing environment. So for example, in the early days of computing, when computers started way back, we, as developers, were told, you have to learn the language of the computer. You have to learn what it can interpret. You have to learn the language, you have to learn the interpreter, you have to know how to write your syntax, and so on and so forth. You have to know how to put in the user input, and blah. Today, expectations are very different. Today, we expect the computer to know what we want. We want the computer to not be, to understand what we mean by pinch and zoom. We want the computer to understand what we mean by scroll. We want the computer to understand what we mean by dismiss. All of these natural user interfaces are something that a consumer naturally expects. Power is a big deal. Most conversations after you bought a device, and tell me if I'm wrong, is how long does your device last? PCs last 3.5 hours, 4 hours, etc. But most conversations about mobile is battery kitni chalti hai. Right or wrong? Yeah? People are conscious about power going forward. People are conscious about security and privacy going forward. When I was coming down to this venue, I checked on Bing Maps what the traffic scenario is. Now, I want maps to tell me what the traffic scenario is, but I don't want the map to tell the whole world where I'm going. Is that a fair expectation? In an earlier world, you would say, okay, fine, whatever, if you want to tell the whole world, go ahead and tell the world. So people are becoming conscious about power, security, privacy, about how we manage our devices, and so on and so forth. And quite honestly, the nature of the web, the nature of the World Wide Web is basically meant to cater to diversity. It is meant to cater to changing environments. That is why the web was born in the first place. So The intent of the, the way we want web to work is really, irrespective of what devices you use, what form factors you use, what natural user inputs you have, you want the web to just work. That is a vision that practically every browser vendor or every vendor working on web as a core technology really wants to achieve, right? As an example, if you went to Hawaiian Airlines a couple of years ago, this is the experience you get. On your Safari, on your I'm just using mobile for, example's sake, but PC wouldn't be much of a different. But see how these three sites are essentially different. That last one is, by the way, Internet Explorer, which is really the one that sucks in all this. But you've got one experience on Safari, you've got one experience in Safari Firefox. Safari also includes Chrome because it's the same WebKit rendering engine that they use. And then you've got Internet Explorer. What you really want to get to is this experience. Is that a fair expectation from a user perspective? Is it a fair expectation that consumers expect us as web developers to give them experiences that are seamless and uniform across the board? That's what you want to drive as one community of web developers and designers. The question then is, this is another example of how you would want to port your experience across PC to the mobile phone person. The question then is, how do we fix these interoperability issues? We're all different companies. Google is a company of its own, Microsoft is a company of its own, Mozilla is a community of their own, Firefox is a community of their own, Opera is a different company. How do we really fix this interoperability, and specifically when W3C as an organization, everyone knows what W3C is, right? Right. W3C as an organization is not very quick in terms of turning around standards and specification. And rightfully so, it goes through a whole process of, when you submit the draft to when it becomes a specification. That may take anywhere between 3 to 5 years, depending on what you submit as a specification. So it is a long-run process, rightfully so, because you have to take into account a whole bunch of things when you announce a particular implementation as a specification. So how do we fix this? And that's where really the whole concept of responsive web comes in. Now, quite honestly, Internet Explorer has been primarily the culprit in not being able to keep up to the standards per se. And the reason for that is really we have a large implementation of applications in enterprises that are specifically catered, or rather married, if you will, to Internet Explorer implementations. So you change a certain specification, you get to the next level of the browser, and all those applications will fail. And that obviously earned us a lot of lag. So we were in this dilemma, whether we move the web forward and ignore everything that happened, or we just ignore the web and just cater to the enterprises. Don't really have a solution to that, but what we've said today is that we will have one Internet Explorer 11 that is going to be standardized for everybody in the enterprise. And then we have a brand new browser called the Microsoft Edge, which is going to be our consumer browser on Windows 10 going forward. Internet Explorer 11 is going to be the last Internet Explorer ever. What we did for that is basically looked at the commonalities between the three browsers, and then looked at the commonality that Internet Explorer had with this, took that entire piece of code, and then put it into a new browser called Microsoft Edge. This is the way we're solving it. But this is not really, this is just one side of the story. There are three more sides of the story and a bunch of other browsers that we need to cater to. So essentially, there are really four core principles that we're asking web developers to cater to, so that as web developers, we can move the entire community forward, we can move the web forward, and we don't really penalize the consumer for having the options to use different devices, different form factors, and different browsers first. So the first thing is browser and feature detection. Typically, every browser sends out a user agent string. I'm sure you've seen this in a whole bunch of the code that you've written, your developers have written, and so on and so forth. This code was basically initially, with all right intent, it was meant to give information about the browser per se. But a gentleman called Patrick Locke said that, quite honestly, user agents is a pack of lies. The more data you feed into it, the more lies it gives you. User agents can be spoofed, user agents can be changed, and therefore the information that you're really getting is wrong. So any code that you write to say, you know, if MSI do this or if Firefox do this, is going to land you into trouble at some point in time. So this is what the web developers did. The reason they did it, because every browser had a different specification for an implementation, and they didn't know how to handle it. The only way to handle it was, you know, checking which browser it is. But forget about the specification for a minute. If you look at just IE, which I'm hoping nobody uses IE6 and IE8 anymore, but you know, there might be some lunatics in the world, you never know. But apart from IE6 and IE7, IE8, IE9, and IE10, and IE11, and hopefully, and now, thankfully, there's a stop to the continuous upgradation of Internet Explorer. But also look at Chrome. Chrome is currently on, I think, Chrome version 43. They have a daily update mechanism. Firefox is, I think, on 14 or something of that sort. So essentially, they're also, everyone is upgrading their browsers every time. And therefore, if you're going to do browser sniffing for a particular implementation, then you're going to have to check for practically every versions that are available across the planet, across the browser ecosystem. You're not going to, there are certain implementations that Chrome has increased in probably a version 43 versus what it had in, let's say, a version 30. So to cater to these challenges, what we really say is, instead of trying to do user agent sniffing, we actually do what we call as feature detection. By feature detection, what we say is, if a particular browser supports a particular feature, then write this code. If it doesn't support a particular feature, then, you know, fall back gracefully. Write some alternative code that caters to practically all the browsers. So it's a single if and then, and so on and so forth. Now, this is not a very difficult thing to do, quite honestly. There are tools like caniuse.com, which basically gives you all the specifications and what browser supports it and what doesn't. Sorry. It's a very powerful tool if you really go about using it. Then there are also very prominent libraries like the modernizer.js, in which you can actually, modernizer is written an if-then exactly like the one I described earlier for every feature implementation that is out there. So you can actually use the modernizer library to test not just JavaScript, but not just DOM properties, but also your CSS properties in terms of whether this browser supports it or not. Yeah, so essentially between browser detection and feature detection, we are going to ask all of our developers to sort of change their approach and start using feature detection to determine whether a particular implementation is supported or not. The second thing is really about CSS and JavaScript prefixes. If you look at CSS prefixes, open code base for any website across the globe, you will find these implementations. MS for Microsoft, Godzilla for Moz for Mozilla, WebKit, and so on and so forth. If there's no prefix, it means it is an approved standard by the W3C governing body. The reason standards or CSS prefixes were created was basically for browsers to experiment with a particular implementation or a draft that they might have submitted to W3C. It doesn't mean that it's going to remain like that in future implementations. It is possible that browser vendors may take off that implementation. So if you're relying on any of these prefixes to do your production workloads, you're actually creating a bit of a problem for yourself if the specification does not go through the way it was charted. So again, one way to sort of handle this situation is to put in all the prefixes for the browsers, but also put in the W3C standards prefix. There are also libraries available like Modernizer and like CaniUse that you could use to actually determine whether that particular CSS property is supported or not. In terms of JS prefixes, we have the exact same problem here as well. If you open some of the older websites, you know, built for i6, i7, you will find a plethora of .ms properties written across the web. Again, this is something that is a huge problem because in future implementations of Internet Explorer, definitely not going to be supported. They are not supported. In Edge, we will essentially use either a WebKit standard or the W3C standard going forward so that you can make sure that the website just works across all the prominent browsers that are there in the ecosystem. So again, JS prefixes, be careful about how you use your, vendor prefixes, whether it's for Microsoft or WebKit and so on and so forth. Then we come to what we really want this web to look like. How are we going to solve these issues around CSS and so on and so forth? If you're looking at being able to port across multiple form factors, then really that is what we really claim to be the core of responsive design. We really think about three things: your flexible layouts, media queries, and the way you scale your media. Media includes images and videos and text sizes and so on and so forth. So flex grid layouts, essentially what we're saying here is you divide your entire web page into columns and rows, and then you of course include spacing and margin between the columns and rows, and then you lay out your entire HTML DOM in those columns and rows. But there's one specific problem that we face out here. Typically, we're in the habit of, and that's the example I've used also, which is kind of funny, but typically we're in the habit of mentioning every element in pixel sizes. The problem with that is a pixel can be one dot on one device, and it could be eight dots on another device. So how do we solve that problem? So the recommendation is, instead of using pixels, use percentages. Because when you're laying out the entire website into rows and columns, you're actually going to be able to identify them using percentages as well. So that's a good way to sort of lay out your flex grids and flex boxes, per se. So in CSS as well as, in fact, if you go to a website called flexgrid.com, it gives you a really nice way to put your entire HTML together that will render beautifully across devices. Use that. This is just an example of fluid layout. It doesn't have to be that every row and column you want to sort of specify exact or equal percentages between each other. You can actually use fluid grids as well, but in every row, every cell can be a different dimension that you may want to use into your applications. If you're not a web developer yourself, this is something you definitely want the new age web developers to take care of. So do let them sort of know. The other thing is scaling media. Typically, what we do is we create an image, and then we say, OK, this image is going to be used, use it for 100%, and that's about it. That creates a problem because when we say max size 100%, on different devices, it's going to appear differently. Instead, what you would do is probably create image size for different resolutions, and then use CSS layouts to figure out what is the right kind of image that you want to use within your application. Media queries is a very, very powerful implementation in CSS, which really lets you lay out your entire style sheet based on the device that you're using. Based on the form factor, based on the resolution, based on the screen size, or based on even the orientation, in this case that I've used an example, that you can actually change your CSS based on that. If it detects a landscape layout, use a particular CSS. Portrait layout, use another. If your screen size is between this and that size, then use a particular CSS. CSS can be used as inline, or you could actually use an entire style sheet externally as well. The third point I'd like to make is on plugins and JavaScript frameworks. So typically in the past, we've had the reason we've needed to use plugins and like Flash, like Adobe, PDF readers, like Media Player, etc., to give a nice and enhanced experience to end users or end consumers. Today, the way W3C has really pulled up the standards, you don't need to do that anymore. Instead of writing a huge object like this, all you want to use is for showing a video file, you probably simply want to use a video tag and get that going. This is true of even when you're trying to do streaming. So the whole specification is upgraded to a great level. But the other reason you definitely want to do this is browsers and browser vendors have taken a stance to say, we will not support plugins going forward. We will not support Silverlight on browsers. We will not support on browsers like Edge. We will not support Flash players and the likes. But then there are situations where we and again, people have written all kinds of things like browser helper objects, ActiveX controls for inputs and 3D rendering and stuff like that. Lots of things have been done which should not be done. All of that can be done by using standards web now. Then there are implementations like your Adobe PDF Reader, which are a necessity today, So how has that been managed? Most of the browser vendors have actually incorporated that specification inside the browser itself. May not be a W3C standard yet, but PDF readers, you don't need to install separately as a plugin. It's just available for on the browser for you to sort of download and read. JavaScript libraries is an interesting implementation. Today, most web developers actually use some sort of a library to help their implementation. For example, some developers use bootstrap.js for a responsive UI, some use jQuery for the UI to be laid out really well, and so on and so forth. Challenge is that JavaScript libraries have the potential of infusing content that you don't know of. It's a library at the end of the day, and you don't really, the code is there for you to open and see, but it is possible that you might see not expected code out there. So the only recommendation there is to ensure that your JavaScript library is always upgraded, always updated, and you're using the latest version from a known community of developers that have done it. jQuery is a very good example. Use jQuery, the latest version at all times, and make sure it is always upgraded. Finally, I want to talk about standards modes, which is a little IE specific. So in the Internet Explorer world, we've always written this kind of DOM header per se. We've declared a doc type. We've said that this is the header that we want. This is the compatible tag that we want to support, and so on and so forth. The fact is that we don't want to do this anymore. We just want to support HTML5 going forward, and therefore we just want to declare doctype HTML as the render, as the edge mode, if you will, from a browser perspective. What this does is it works well on, because it's two spec, it works well on Chrome, it works well on Firefox for your website, it works well on Edge and IE11. On 9 and 10, it triggers a standards mode. In 8 downwards, it triggers a quirks mode. So essentially, your website will work well. If you continue to use the ones on top, then despite the fact that you're using an HTML5, you will not be able to. The user will not experience it as an HTML5 because the browser will default it to one of the earlier modes of implementation, render modes of implementation. So then the question really is, so these are the 4 points that I want to talk to you about. The next question is, how do I know that my site is not to standards? Do you want to sort of go through the entire code base and evaluate and so on and so forth? Not really. There are many tools that are available online that help you do this. One of the tools is something that we've built and we've open sourced it so that people can modify it to their purposes. The tool is available on aka.mssitescan. Feel free to use that. Feel free to get your result set of how your site looks and make the changes as possible. I would also recommend that you evaluate and use bootstrap.js for building responsive websites, and also use JavaScript libraries like Warlon for .js for testing across mobile devices. I think I forgot to put it down there, but use Warlon.js for testing across mobile devices per se and form factors. Warlon, Warlon.js. Bootstrap.js for responsive UI, Warlon.js for testing across mobile form factors and so on and so forth. If you go to SiteScan, this site that I specified out here, you'll find additional testing tools as well that you can use for your website. So we've actually undertaken this whole challenge of, because quite honestly, Internet Explorer has been the forefront of not moving the web forward too much earlier. We've taken this challenge of helping developers move the web forward. I definitely am going to appeal for your support to be able to do this. If you have any queries on, if there's anything you need in terms of, hey, my site is not working on this particular mode, or I want some help to sort of understand how HTML5 implementation works, write to us at modernweb@microsoft.com, and I'd be more than happy to, me and the team will be more than happy to help you out with it. I'm also available on Twitter. Aditee Rele is my handle if you want to reach out. With that, 1 minute to go. I'd like to say thank you for listening to me, and we do need help from all the web developer community and the hosting community as well, because I'm sure you guys reach out to, you know, websites that put up their sites to help us move the web forward. I do have a bunch of stickers somewhere, which I don't know where they are right now, but I'll figure out. I'll leave them here if you want to pick up something and put up, like I have one for my laptop, that'd be really nice. And I'm happy to take questions if you have any. Maybe I should just come down.
Aditee, thank you for coming, and it's really inspiring. Apart from the IT aspect, as a woman, this happened as a little idea, Women Wonderful, and I started it thinking that if there are 15 women, I started it on Facebook, like-minded, will not on guy bashing or each other bashing, but look at their own potential and see how to, you know, maximize it. I created it thinking if there are 15 women, at least 3 would be up for coffee, but it's reached almost 1,500 women without any kind of advertisement.
Awesome.
And also we've been written about by Hindustan Times Chandigarh, and now it's grown out of my hands, it's gone to the next level. And this set of, these women here are obviously educated because they're online, and they come from all varied backgrounds, right from the CEO, one of them is the director of Monte Carlo Fashions, and as a lawyer, homemaker, you name it, they're all there. And you as your tech evangelist for Microsoft in India, I really love, we are in the process of helping them to become entrepreneurs, and it's my personal mission. I'm in love with the internet. This is my first, you know, internet or web seminar, IRC, with whom I buy my domains. They said that this is where you should be, it's a new world you should step into. And I really would like to take your help, how we can make these women, you know, understand the internet and how they can, make the online presence more better.
Sure, just a quick scan to see there are about 2 or 3 women out here. Or maybe more, I don't know. But that's a great initiative. Thank you for starting that. We did something called Microsoft Women in Technology. And again, I don't know if this is a conversation to have right now. Maybe we can take it
offline. Yeah, I'd like to have a few minutes to a picture, because I'd like to write an article about that.
Thank you. That was a different context altogether, but interesting. You guys should also encourage women in your organizations to, you know, attend seminars like this. Any questions on the responsive web piece? No? Okay, great. So, Suzanne, can you get those stickers out to people if they want? Thank you. Thanks, everyone, for listening to me.
All right, thank you, Aditee, so much. I'm sure everyone's really going to be benefiting from that. There you go.